Chapter 2. The Nobilis Decurio. Joseph of Arimathea was a man of refinement, well-educated, and one who possessed many talents. He had extraordinary political and business ability, and was reputed to be one of the wealthiest men in the world of that time. He was the Carnegie of his day, a metal magnate controlling the tin and lead industry, which then was akin in importance to that of steel today. Tin was the chief metal for the making of alloys and in great demand by the warring Romans. Many authorities claim that Joseph's world control of tin and land was due to his vast holdings in the famous ancient tin mines of Britain. Citation: See St. Joseph of Arimathea at Glastonbury, pages 31 through 32. This interest he had acquired and developed many years before Jesus was baptized by his cousin, John the Baptist, and before he began his brief but glorious mission. The world's major portion of tin was mined in Cornwall, smelted into ingots, and exported throughout the then known civilized world, chiefly in the ships of Joseph. He is reputed to have owned one of the largest private merchant shipping fleets afloat, which traversed the world's sea lanes in the transportation of this precious metal. The existence of the tin trade between Cornwall and Phoenicia is frequently referred to by classical writers and is described at considerable length by Diodorus Siculus as well as Julius Caesar in the Latin Vulgate of the Gospel of St. Mark 15:43 and St. Luke 23:50. We find both referring to Joseph of Arimathea as Decurio. This was the common term employed by the Romans to designate an official in charge of metal mines. In St. Jerome's translation, Joseph's official title is given as Nobilis Decurio. This indicates that he held a prominent position in the Roman administration as a minister of mines. For a Jew to hold such a high rank in the Roman state is rather surprising and goes far to prove the remarkable characteristics of Joseph. We know he was an influential member of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish religious body that ruled Roman Jewry, and a legislative member of a provincial Roman Senate. His financial and social standing can well be estimated when we consider he owned a palatial home in the Holy City and a fine country residence just outside Jerusalem. Several miles north of the ancient city, he possessed another spacious estate at Arimathea, which is known today as Ramallah. It was located on the populous caravan route between Nazareth and Jerusalem. Everything known of him points to him as affluent and as a person of importance and influence within both the Jewish and Roman hierarchies. According to the Talmud, Joseph was the younger brother of the father of the Virgin Mary. He was her uncle, and therefore a great uncle to Jesus. Chiefly from the secular reports, we learn that Joseph was a married man, and his son Josephus left a mark of distinction in British history. During the lifetime of Jesus, there constantly appears reference to his association with a relative at Jerusalem. Profane history is more positive on the matter, identifying the connection with Joseph. As we study the old records, we find there is a valid reason for close association of Jesus and his family with Joseph. It is quite obvious that the husband of Mary died while Jesus was young. Under Jewish law, such a circumstance automatically appointed the next male kin of the husband, in this case Joseph, legal guardian of the family. This fact explains many things. History and tradition report Jesus as a boy, frequently in the company of his uncle, particularly at the time of the religious feasts, and declares that Jesus made voyages to Britain with Joseph in his ships. Cornish traditions abound with this testimony, and numerous ancient landmarks bear Hebrew names recording these visits. Even during the short period of the ministry of Jesus, there is definitely shown to exist a close affinity between them, far greater than one would expect from an ordinary guardianship. It was fatherly, loyal, with a mutual affection death could never sever. We know that Joseph never forsook his nephew. He stood by him as a bold, fearless defender at the notorious trial and defied the Sanhedrin by going to Pilate and boldly claiming the body when all others feared to do so. His arms were the first to cradle the broken corpse when taken from the cross and place it in the tomb. After death, he continued to protect the mutilated body of Jesus from the conspiring minds of the Sadducees. He risked his all, wealth, power, and position in those crucial years, fulfilling his obligation as guardian of Jesus and of the family of Mary. He loved Jesus dearly. The disciples spoke of Joseph with an affectionate regard. They wrote he was a just man and a good man, honorable, and a disciple of Jesus. The latter clearly indicates that all through their association, Joseph must have encouraged Jesus in his great work and that he was aware of the mystery of his birth and probably his destiny. All evidence proves that Joseph believed in the validity of all Jesus taught and ultimately suffered for. Citation. C.F. Joseph's Testimony, Gospel of Nicodemus, chapter 9, verses 5 through 11. It is commonly taught that Jesus was poor and of obscure relatives. His relationship with the affluent Joseph of Arimathea proves otherwise. In his own right, he was a property owner, but long before he took up his mission, he forsook all material wealth. It should be remembered that Jesus was a true lineal descendant of the shepherd king David and of Seth, son of Adam, who was the son of God.